The defrosted cadaver is one of the best labs we can have to learn surgical techniques of abdominal wall reconstruction. Once the midline is cut, the retrorectus space is dissected systematically. The incision on the posterior rectus sheath should be made as close to the midline as possible. Incision is carried out laterally to meet the lateral border of the posterior rectus sheath, locating the neurovascular bundles. The incision is continued downwards to reach arcuate line and the prepternal fat of rectus. Laterally, the epigastric vessels are retracted within the rectus muscle. At this level, we should leave the fat attached to these vessels to avoid their injury, but also will give us the right plane on the retroinguinal area to reach the Cooper ligaments. Cranially, we stop the medial incision on the posterior rectus sheath about 6 cm below the xiphoid and do not dissect the retrorectus space at this area. We then identify the branches from the 7 to 9 intercostal nerves that run very medially near the transversus abdominis muscle. The same steps are followed in the right side. The more medial we cut the posterior rectus sheath, the more we can take of the anterior rectus sheath and posterior rectus sheath for our abdominal wall reconstruction. Cranially, we insist in stop the cutting of the medial border of the posterior rectus sheath of the retromuscular dissection about 6 cm below the xiphoid, and we don't dissect more laterally the dissection in this epigastric area. We can here discern the myofascial limit of the transversus abdominis muscle. Here we show how we follow the medial incision and we stop there in the cranial part on both sides. This way the fatty triangle is very wide and we then start the preparatory dissection below the xiphoid and laterally to the preserved posterior rectus sheaths. So we can access the plane described by Nowinski before starting the posterior component separation. We like to perform this dissection laterally first and then in the midline, leaving the fat pad attached to the xiphoid. Two constant vessels on both sides of the xiphoid are easily controlled with conventional electrocautery in real patients. Taking the advantage of this prepternal fat distribution at the epigastric area, we extended cranially and laterally the space between the prepternal fat and the posterior rectus sheath. In cases where the peritoneum is too thin, we can also dissect a step up between the fascia transversalis and the transversus abdominis that comes very medially at this level. It would be a prefascia transversalis layer. Here we remark that the posterior rectus sheath insertion is preserved on both sides and the fatty triangle of Conse is dissected following the shape of trident of the prepternal fat. Following the dome shape of the diaphragm, the layer is continued, peeling the diaphragm off the fascia diaphragmatica. This way we will avoid iatrogenic morganic hernias through the diaphragm. Here we are showing the preservation of the posterior rectus sheath insertions on costochondral cartilages and the preservation of the nerves that comes to innervate the rectus abdominis muscle. This dissection can be followed up to the central tendon without starting the lateral release on the posterior rectus sheath. The camera is now focusing from the head and down into the pelvis. We are now dissecting the rectus space and both retroinguinal areas. The video shows the right retroinguinal dissection with parietalization of the prismatic vessels and vas deferens as in a conventional TEP or TAP inguinal hernia repair. Lateral to the spermatic vessels, the prepternal plane can be dissected below the arcuate line and extended laterally before performing the posterior component separation. Sometimes the peritoneum can be very attached to the lateral border of the arcuate line. Having performed the prepternal dissection first superiorly at the epigastric and subxiphoid areas and inferiorly at the Bogor's spaces, we are ready to start the posterior component separation. The use of a finger can help to separate the peritoneal layer from the posterior rectus sheath. We usually start the lateral release of the posterior retrocis at the arcuate line, medial to the neurovascular bundles, and then come parallel the lateral border of the posterior retrocis as far as the level of the umbilicus. Then we turn obliquely, following the myofascial limit of the transverse abdominis muscle to find the medial incision of the posterior retrocis made in the retromuscular ribs dissection. As soon as we incise the first centimeters, we extend laterally the dissection in a preputenal plane behind the transversus abdominis muscle. At this level, we keep the fascia transversalis attached to the transversus abdominis muscle. This lateral extension releases the tension on the peritoneum, preventing tears on it. Here we can check that from the umbilicus we follow the myofascial limit of the transversus abdominis muscle in order to cut only the insertion of the muscle on the posterior retrocis. Precisely, this is the part of the abdomen where the peritoneum is thinner and more stuck to the posterior retrocis. In the superior part of the abdomen, we advocate to perform the lateral extension in a pre-transversalis plane, as the peritoneum is not protected here by the peritoneal fat distribution. We are now communicating the lateral incision on the posterior retrocis with the medial incision made in the beginning. As we have performed the preputenal upper transversalis dissection in the epigastric area, we enable the detachment of the peritoneum from the posterior retrocis despite tears that could potentially be made at this more difficult area. The lateral extension is kept in this superior part in the pretransversalis plane. We like to obtain a very large overlap. Here we can see the lateral release of the posterior retrocis following the insertion of the transversus abdominis and the preservation of the cranial insertion of the posterior retrocis. Here we observe that the peritoneal plane is following the lower part and the pretransversalis plane in the upper part. Similarly, in the left side, we start the posterior component separation down to up at the arcuate line, again with the aid of the initial finger detachment of the peritoneum from the posterior retrocis. There is a constant nerve branch above the umbilical level that can be also preserved following the semilunar line. The lateral incision is carried out obliquely to come across the medial incision of the posterior retrocis that was stopped about 6 cm below the xiphoid. We can observe here the layers that contribute to form the posterior retrocis: the posterior lamella of the internal oblique muscle and the terminal fibers of the transversus abdominis muscle. Here we join both incisions, the posterior component separation is completed. We insist to keep our plane in a pretransversalis layer in this superior part of the abdomen, as the peritoneum can be extremely thin. Cranially, we extend the overlap, as Nowicki advocates, to the central tendon. In this subdiaphragmatic area, the fascia transversalis is complete in continuity with the fascia diaphragmatica. This fascia almost disappears in the central tendon, as this fascia diaphragmatica takes part in the anatomical insertion on this central tendon. So, it is easier to make holes in the peritoneum just beneath the central tendon.